When the day is done and there's no one else around, while I'm lying here in bed, you're in my heart, you're in my head. You're all I need, you're all I need. There are a million voices calling out my name. You're the one I wanna hear, so make the others disappear. You're all I need, you're all I need. You are all I need when I'm surrounded. You are all I need if I'm by myself. You fill me when I'm empty. There is nothing else, you're all I need.
Broadcast. It is the weekend of May 8th and 9th, Mother's Day weekend. So we celebrate all mothers and all women who have been nurturers throughout their lives. We celebrate God's love extended through each of you to others that you have nurtured over the years. Thanks be to God for each and every one of you. Thank you all for joining us this morning online as we gather to worship our Lord and Savior. Be sure to hit that like button down below on your screen or hit the subscribe to join us each week for our worship service. We'll do more announcements at the end of our service this morning. But just a reminder that we are in that post-Easter sermon series, On the High Seas with Jesus. Today we focus on the brig of all things on a ship. And that reminder that discipline and guidance are something that we all need in our lives, especially as we think about moms today. May God's word continue to strengthen us and uplift us as we gather to worship this day. So we gather in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, cleanse our hearts from sin and make us pure within. Let us confess our sinfulness before Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your holy name. Amen. Hear this good news, and the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ, was given to die for you, and for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them his Holy Spirit. Amen.
The peace of God, the love of Christ, and the hope of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray, Sovereign Lord, you guide our lives. Thank you for keeping us afloat in the ocean of life through storms and sunny days. Sometimes, however, we turn from your direction and think that we know a better way. In those times, give us our holy discipline so we might learn from our mistakes and return to sailing under your guidance. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Say good morning, church, everybody.
Good morning!
Yeah. We are here again with the kids of the church, your kids, so you're on the hook for anything they say today, all right? We are going to do another episode of Church Kids Say the Darndest Church Things, and for Mother's Day, we're going to do a fun Mother's Day edition of the children's message where your kids, these kids, say hi, kids.
Hi!
are going to share their words of wisdom about how to be a good mother to an expectant mother. So, you guys ready to do this?
Yay!
Yeah?
Colton, what is your advice for a first-time mom?
Be brave and confident.
Be brave and confident. That's a good one, Colton.
Yeah, starting off strong.
I would put not as much furniture and carpets in the baby's room because it might poop all over it, so you might have to wash this sheets a billion times.
To have faith.
Faith in, like, herself? Faith in... Faith in the child, but the child... Okay. Share your words of wisdom for a first-time mother. What advice do you have?
Be thankful for what you have and what you're gonna get.
Be thankful for what you have and for what you're gonna get. Is she going to get only good stuff from here on out?
No.
Make sure they have a clean diaper and don't pee everywhere.
That's good advice. Yes. What happens? What's your advice for when she gets stuff that's not so good? What should she do? Try harder to get better stuff? Yeah, Katie, try harder to get better stuff.
Will do.
Is there still going to be stuff to be thankful for even in the bad times?
Yeah.
In cases that they do accidentally pee everywhere, what then? What do we do? Just throw out the whole thing and start over? Yeah? Okay. Faith in anybody else in particular?
Herself.
Herself?
And her family.
In her family? Share with us a way to get your child to love you as a mother.
Feed them ice cream every night?
Yes.
Specifically,
what should she do to be a good mom to a girl? Speaking as a girl, you're an expert on this.
Lots of shoes.
Shoes?
When I was a baby, when I was supposed to be taking a nap, I had to go potty, and I pooped, and I spread it all over my room. Like, don't let that happen.
Don't let that happen, okay?
What did your mom do in that situation?
Whoa.
I would just burn the house down and get a new one.
Whoa.
Faith in any other, like, higher being?
God.
Yeah, there we go. Yeah. Having faith in God, probably a big one to be a mom. Yeah? Give us your advice.
To love each other.
To love, like, for me and Katie to love each other?
No, the baby toys!
Oh, what can Katie do to be a good mom?
Be a good mom.
Oh, she just needs to be a good mom to be a good mom? Who else needs to be loving?
Yeah!
Oh, okay. Me? All right.
Buy them tons of toys.
Buy them tons of toys, okay.
Just toys? Anything else?
Food.
Why toys and food?
Important things.
Okay, all right.
There you have it.
More important than Jesus?
No.
Okay, just making sure we know where your heart's at. What if they, like, get sick? I hear that's bad for children.
Just let them get through it?
All right, okay. Can we call you?
No.
Oh, thanks.
Don't give your kid everything they want and make them clean your room.
Make the kid clean our room?
No, their room.
Oh, can I make her clean my room?
To a certain extent?
Maybe
don't
all.
Don't make her a servant.
Oh.
Don't make her a servant. Oh.
Is that not what we're doing here?
No.
Oh. Okay. Well, then I might need to readjust. Does your mom have faith in Jesus?
Yes.
Has that worked out for her so far?
What?
Yeah. Good.
So there you have it. An easy step-by-step process to be a good mom. If any of you moms out there didn't know all of those things already, now you do. And of course, as always, like, what's the number one thing a mother should be teaching her child?
To love Jesus!
To love Jesus, right? That's the biggest thing. And even though none of you said that, that's still important, right? Do you think we can pray about that, you guys?
Yeah!
All right, cool. Our hands we fold, our heads we bow. It's time to talk to
God right now!
Repeat after me. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Thank you for moms. Thank you for kids.
Thank you for kids.
And thank you for that special relationship between them.
Thank you for that special relationship between them.
We love you, Jesus.
We love you, Jesus.
In your name we pray.
In your name we pray.
Amen.
And have you completely forgotten this word of encouragement that addresses you as a father addresses his son? It says, "My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord's discipline, the one he loves, and has chastened everyone he accepts as his son, endured hardship and as discipline, God is treating you as his children. For what children are not disciplined by their fathers? If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are not legitimate, not true sons and daughters at all. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respect them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of the spirits and life? They discipline us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, in order that we may share his holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. Therefore, strengthening your feeble arms and weak knees, make level paths for your feet, so that the lame may not be disciplined, but rather healed."
Grace and peace be to you from the one who is the resurrection and the life, Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. Our sermon series titled for this post-Easter message series is On the High Seas with Jesus, and it is focused on various parts of the ship. Today, the theme is the brig. Yes, that space on a vessel that is dedicated to housing persons who have stepped over the line. It is basically a small onboard jail for passengers and crew. With today being Mother's Day, I want to thank all the motherly types who have taken the responsibility for placing your crew members in the brig when need be. I think primarily of my dearly departed mom, who in her role in the family was the captain of the ship when it came to dispensing discipline. Wasn't any of this nonsense of her telling us kids, just wait until your father gets home tonight. No, mom was swift and to the point. She used a wooden paddle, and that was her tool of implementation when it came to warming our backside. Wasn't any of this business of let's go to timeout, or I'm going to take away a certain toy from you. No. Mom used this wooden paddle, and it was kept in the far drawer just to the right of the kitchen sink. And when she pulled out that plank, there was no warning signal to it. She meant business. She was going to make a behavioral adjustment. I'm reminded of an opa who was babysitting his grandchild. Mom and dad were out for a while on a date. The child began to act up, misbehave, be disrespectful. Opa gave a warning for that errant behavior, and said he'd spank if need be. Well, the child continued pushing the boundaries, so Opa gave the boy a firm swat on the behind. The little child was totally surprised. He cried and ran to his room. Upon the parents' return, the child whimpered to his mom, "Opa doesn't know how to count." Meaning, of course, there wasn't any of this 1, 2, 2.5, 2.75, 3. My mom did not know how to count either. She was a old school. Corporal application was her style. There were no ifs or ands, only buts. I thank God for my mom disciplining me through the years. And though it was not ever pleasant, it certainly helped shape me to respect authority and have an obedient heart for rules. And I believe it thus aided me in respecting God's authority and God's desire for me to comply to his word and to his will. Our Bible passage today says that God disciplines us. And I'm not sure that we often think about a God as a disciplinarian. I'm not talking about a wrathful God in which the Bible records many stories of people who wickedly rejected him.
You know, like the time that the Lord sent the great flood, he did that to rebuke an immoral world. Or when the time he rained fire and brimstone from heaven upon the people of Sodom and Gomorrah, they had no regard for his rules. Or the time he erased an entire Egyptian army by closing the Red Sea on them as the children of Israel escaped slavery. These stories and more are of an angry, agitated God pushed to the limits, who became infuriated with a rebellious people whose mocking and disregard of his sovereignty led them to experience the rage of the Almighty. And though discipline may have an element of punishment at times, discipline contains more of the properties of teaching and correction. That's why our Bible passage today from Hebrews says, the Lord disciplines those whom he loves. You see, discipline's purpose is to guide us back, to turn us around, to lead us back into the fold of a right relationship with our Lord, not to wipe us out. And thus it is for all who are human and in a rebellious state that we have sometimes erred against God and erred against others. Biblically, I think of the story of King David, who allowed lust and power to take over his heart as he committed adultery and then murder, attempting to cover up one sin with another. God disciplined David with a strong head-on confrontation from the prophet Nathan. And God did this in order to bring David to his knees, bring him to his knees in repentance, and reel him back in to a right relationship with God. I think of Peter who was called out by Jesus Christ. When Peter tried to tell the Lord, don't go to the cross, let's keep doing what we're doing. To which the Lord then singed Peter's tail feathers with these fiery words. He said, get behind me, Satan, for you are not on God's side, but on the side of humans. Jesus disciplined his very good friend Peter with harsh, harsh words in order to correct him, turn him around with respect to his understanding of Christ's purpose here on earth. I think again of Peter. Peter, who denied his Lord, and without a word, only a piercing stare, Jesus looked at Peter, and Peter's heart was cut to the core, and he quickly exited and wept in great remorse. You know, I even think of a St. Paul who was arresting and killing Christians, and with a lightning bolt from heaven, he was knocked off of his high horse, initially blinded. And God did this in order to shape Paul, turn him around, lead him in the direction to be the Billy Graham of his day. The Bible clearly says that God disciplines those whom he loves. In order for people to be reminded that God is God, not them, not us. But bring us to repentance. Place us again on the correct path. Adjust our course towards him. Hey, a few years back, the vehicle that I drove was eating up my tires. I'd replaced them a time or two, and that gets expensive. But you know, I'm not very good at remembering to rotate my tires regularly. And this was more than a rotation issue. It was happening just on the front wheels. The outside edges of the tires, where the rubber is right there, was wearing down a whole lot quicker than it should have been. Well, I took it over to Strayer and Offers, who quickly diagnosed the problem as my front end was out of line. They did a front end alignment, and the tire problem was gone. You see, our God seeks to offer us an alignment of our attitude and our behavior through some type of discipline from time to time, so that our faith journey is adjusted to a path according to his will, as opposed to ruining our relational tires, so to speak, with him and with others. But I have to ask this really penetrating question. It's the question of the day. How does God discipline us these days? Well, what might that look like? What does it not look like? How does God alter our attitudes and modify our behavior to be more in line with His word and will instead of our own? I want to make a distinction here. A distinction not only between punishment, which I gave some examples in the Bible, punishment that we're not talking about. And of course, as we made that distinction with love, discipline and love being about correction and direction and teaching, I want to make that distinction as well as the distinction of thinking about pain and suffering and problems that we experience in our lives. You see, I believe that God disciplines us in love because the Bible says that He does. And of course, God can do whatever God chooses to do because God is God. But the further question is all tragedy or are all crises and heartbreaks, injustices and misfortunes, are these a result of God disciplining us? And I believe that the answer is no. There's a huge distinction between what might be God's hand of gentleness given in love, God's hand of discipline, versus the times that we as humans make poor decisions and then have to suffer the consequence of those poor decisions. Or when bad things happen to even good people, just because we live in a broken, imperfect, fallen world. For example, I tore my knees up in high school sports. What was that? Because God was disciplining me at the time for acting arrogant because I thought that I was a decent athlete? Or was it due to the fact that tall, lanky kids with chicken-like legs aren't built to play football? I'm not 100% sure, but I don't think it was discipline as much as it was due to my skinny drumsticks. Or the time my high school girlfriend broke up and handed me my heart on a platter. What was that, God disciplining me for some past sin? Or was it because I treated her like dirt and she got tired of it? I'm not 100% sure on this, but I have a sneaking suspicion it was because of the way that I treated her. Or the time that I went to the doctor for a regular checkup and walked away after some tests and discovered I had prostate cancer. Is that God reprimanding me for some trespass I haven't confessed and repented of? Or is it because none of us are immune to illnesses in this life? I'm pretty sure it's because sickness is just a part of this broken world. You know, some people of faith may say that all the above examples that I shared are examples of God's disciplining me. But to be honest, I have to ask, really? Really? How do you know that? I mean, I know that I'm not all that wise when it comes to such matters. I'm not perfectly spiritually in tune to be able to determine what might be God's discipline versus what are dumb choices on the part of VTech versus what are the things that happen in my life that are a result that I live in a broken, imperfect world and bad things will even happen to good and faithful people. But there are some people who think that catastrophes like Hurricanes Katrina and Rita were God's disciplines on a sin-sick city of New Orleans. How do they know that? Did God write and tell them? I mean, some people may also say that AIDS and the COVID are sent as God's discipline on a nation and a world that is morally decayed. Gosh, I wish that I were that connected with God to know exactly how He operates. You see, I just don't have the spiritual savvy to distinguish these things like other people may say that they can. But I don't believe. I don't believe that God brings anguish and torment and affliction upon us. I don't believe that God has his hand on the wheel of a drunk driver, steering that car to a head-on collision with teenagers. And that he would do that as a correction for some sin that the kids committed. Or that he's responsible for someone getting lung cancer after 40 years of them smoking. I don't see that God dishes out discipline by devastating a town with a tornado, or causing a child to be born with deformities, or a couple not being able to have children, or a husband and a wife ending up in divorce court. I know that sometimes we might ask if God is getting us when we experience some harsh thing in life. But I don't see God, if God disciplines us in love, as a smiter, one who inflicts pain and suffering upon us. And though my pipeline with God certainly does not allow me to know the specific cause of any of these bad things in life, I do know this. Anytime that we may experience anything from a light slap on the wrist to a punch in the gut to a devastating event in our lives, it causes us to feel like we have been tossed into the brig. Yes, when we feel like we're behind steel bars, it is time to pause. It's the cause to pause. It's time to slow down in life, to ponder things a bit, to maybe take inventory, to confess and repent if need be. And honestly admit just how powerless at times we are, how frail and faulty, how weak and vulnerable, how helpless we are to bust ourselves out of the brig. Especially when the brig of all brigs locks us up and we are destined to die not only physically, but eternally as our everlasting punishment for our sins. With absolutely no ability to spring ourselves from sin or selfishness or ultimately eternal confinement. I'm reminded of that Monopoly game board game and that little card that you can pick up out of chance, I think it is. You land on a certain space, you pick up a card and one of them says, go to jail. Go directly to jail. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. But our card reads, go to hell. Go directly to hell. And without God, without the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we find ourselves permanently in the pokey with no way out. Yet in the midst of any possible disciplines that God may give or due to the problems on dumb choices and decisions that we have made, or just because this life on this planet Earth, can be dark and broken, God yet did not leave us to rot in hell's jail. As our Bible story says today, God ultimately applies his love. His love, his grace, his mercy. And that love, grace, and mercy was sent by God with the one who has the key. The key to release us from our bondage, to unbind us from our infirmities, to liberate us from whatever shackles us, to rescue us from whatever may imprison us. And God did this by sending his innocent son to take our guilty place and land himself in the brig, on the cross, and going to hell for us, receiving the sentence that we should have deserved. There's a fable told of a prisoner of war. This man was sentenced to die at dawn. He was chained to the wall in a dark cell, and yet early before dawn's early rise, he could hear the footsteps of a lone Nazi soldier making his way to his cell block. He swallowed hard. He heard the iron door creak open. The hangman approached, Reaching for his arms, the German uncuffed the American and in a soft voice whispered, "Shh, remove your uniform." To which the inmate stripped his body and expected some form of abuse. But to his surprise, watched as the German soldier undressed as well. "Put on my uniform," said the German. As the American did, he watched the Nazi do the same thing with his clothing. What's happening? Asked the prisoner of war. "The Germans will never know," said the Nazi. "All they need to see is someone in a uniform swing today." "Why are you doing this?" asked the soon-to-be free man. "I have a car outside with my 3 children inside of it. I want you to make sure that they find freedom in America." Christ willingly took on our clothing of the flesh, and then he took on the harsh punishment of being cast in hell's brig instead of us, trading places so that we might be free from being destined there ourselves. And not always being freed from the brigs of this world, but providing a jailbreak from Satan's ideas that he puts in our head that we can't be forgiven, or doubts that he places in our hearts that we'll never make anything of ourselves in this world, or past guilts and trespasses that sometimes suffocate us, won't let us breathe. And ultimately from hell's cell, so that we might not face eternal damnation. That's why Jesus came. That's why he died on the cross. That's why he rose from the dead, to take on the suffering that was due us, giving us that get out of jail free card with his resurrection from that grave brig on Easter. The last time my mom physically disciplined me, I was 16 years old. I'd lied to her. I mocked her to her face. The paddle in the kitchen was long gone, but she hauled off in that moment and slapped the living daylights out of me, not across the face, but right across my shoulder. Certainly didn't feel good. I didn't like it. I deserved it. I also noticed in that moment that after she struck me, she winced. And I could tell that she injured her wrist. And then my smart aleck mouth had to kick in and spout, "Ha! That didn't hurt me." My mom quickly turned, ran off crying at my insult. That video still burns fresh in my mind some 47 years later. I had realized that my sin hurt her far more than she had hurt me. Our sin, our brokenness, hurts Christ far more than we will ever feel the effects of any form of pain in this life. And he took it on. He did it so that we might be released from the brigs that we encounter. On this Mother's Day, I invite you not only to join me in thanking those motherly types who disciplined us in love along the way, but also to thank God in Christ for the love that he gives us, freeing us from the brig in this life, and particularly in the one to come. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Lord please be with everyone that has a big test upcoming this May. Please help them pass the test and advance advance to the next grade level. And please help everyone make good decisions this summer break. Lord, hear our prayer.
Dear God, thank you for this day and everything that you give us. Thank you for our school districts and our teachers. And thank you for blessing us in abundant ways, God. I ask that you just help us finish this year strong. And please be with everyone through these tough times. In your name we pray. Amen.
God, thank you for sending your son to die for us and all our blessings. Thank you for the school year winding down and things returning to normal. Please be with the athletes advancing in track and all the seniors as they start a new chapter in their life.
Lord God, we thank you that you care enough for each and every one of us to offer us accountability for our actions and our deeds, which can lead us to rebel against you on occasion. Continue to nurture us with your law, your love, and an extra measure of your amazing grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord, be with all those who are sick or ill. We pray for Larry Revis and Calvin Audie, who were hospitalized this past week. We pray for those on hospice, Mildred Hinkey and Milton Bowes. And Lord, for those for whom grief is still fresh and raw, that they may find hope in you, who are the resurrection and the life, that promise that we hold on to. Lord God, be with each and every one of us, anyone who may be in need of any type of healing, be it physical, emotional, or spiritual, and for your blessing and your love to surround each and every one of us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we want to lift up to you our church as we are in the process of calling an additional pastor. Guide our call committee, our council leaders, and our whole church in this process. And Lord, open the door to that person that you are seeking to join our ministry staff. May we continue to keep this prayer always before you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. It is time for communion, so if you have your communion ready, your bread and your wine, please get that out now. We'll say the words of institution, bless those elements, join together in the Lord's Prayer, and then share in communion together. So we are reminded that in that night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. When he'd given thanks to God and had broken it, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he'd given thanks to God, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, given and shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Now, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and help us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go ahead and take your bread, and please join with me. The body of Christ, given for you. And now your wine, the blood of Christ, shed for your sins. Now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for this precious gift of life through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who went to the cross to die for our sin, to forgive us, and to take the punishment that we deserve upon himself, so that we might be set free from that bondage of sin, free to live for you here and now and in your kingdom to come. Guide us, enrich us, encourage us, empower us by the power of your Holy Spirit to be examples for others in our world today. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before we depart today, just a few announcements and reminders. First of all, our special offering for this month of May is for our Grace Center, the support to create that safe house for victims of domestic violence in our community. So we appreciate your special gifts and offerings and your regular gifts and offerings, and are thankful to God for your generosity. A reminder that this weekend we began our loosened protocols for the COVID for our in-person events. So beginning this weekend for the in-person worship services, 6 p.m. on Saturday and 10:30 a.m. on Sunday, those are mask optional. The 8 o'clock service will still be mask required. So just a reminder about that. And social distancing will continue to be encouraged, though we'll be removing some of those barriers, but still encourage that as we think about and care about our neighbors. Also, all meetings, office visits, Sunday school, and other programs are mask optional. Other items will be visited by your leadership on a month-by-month basis. Thank you for bearing with us as we slowly get back to worship and being among each other in fellowship, Christian fellowship. Also, one other reminder, Global Leadership Summit registration is open now. There's a discount for Holy Ghosters at a great rate of $99. That goes up until July 13th. This event takes place August 5th and 6th. You can call the office for more information or email the office for more information on that particular event. And now for our sending.
The worship has ended.
And the service begins.
We leave to live out God's call.
To save the lost and strengthen the saved.
People of God, go to be and make disciples.
Blessings and teachings in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And remember this promise, he is with you always.
Even till the end of time.